everybody.
So Whitney and I have a fun animal song this morning, but we're gonna need your help. There is a really fun chorus that repeats about 25,000 times that is much more fun if you sing it with me. So would it be okay if we took a minute to learn the chorus together, and then every time it's time for the chorus, I can point to you and we can sing it together? I'm gonna take that as a yes. All right, so Whitney, would you play the chords for us for the refrain?
All right.
So I will sing it the first time and teach you the words, okay?
All God's creatures got a place in the choir. Some sing low and some sing higher. Some sing out loud on the telephone wire. Some just clap their or pause or anything they got now.
Now, I'm not an alto, so that's kind of why I need your help. All right, so the words go, all God's creatures got a place in the choir. Some sing low and some sing higher. Some sing out loud on the telephone wire, and some just clap their hands or paws or anything they got. Are we ready to try that? Let's do it. All right, so we'll do the, I'll sing the first line, sing it back to me, okay?
All God's creatures got a place in the choir.
Woo, that sounds good this morning, and I'm sure it sounds beautiful online too.
Some sing low and some sing higher.
Beautiful.
Some sing out loud on the telephone wire.
Oh, I'm so glad I asked for your help on that one.
Some just clap their hands or paws or anything they got now.
All right, let's try that chorus all together. Ready, Whitney?
Yep.
All right.
All God's creatures got a place in the choir. Some sing low and some sing higher. Some sing out loud on the telephone wire. Some just clap their hands or paws or anything they got now.
All right, how does that feel? Do we feel like we got it? All right, so we're gonna start off by singing that together, and then I'm gonna sing a verse, and then I'm gonna point to you, and then I'm gonna sing a verse. You get how this goes, right? All right, let's do it.
All God's creatures got a place in the choir. Some sing low and some sing higher. Some sing out loud on the telephone wire. Some just clap their hands or paws or anything they got now.
Woo!
Listen to the bass, it's the one. Autumn. The bullfrog croaks and the hippopotamus moans and groans with a big to-do. The old cow just goes, moo!
Go!
God's creatures got a place in the choir. Some sing low and some sing higher. Some sing out loud on the telephone wire. Some just clap their hands or paws or anything they got now. The dogs and the cats, they take up the middle while the honeybee hums and the cricket. The donkey brays and the pony neighs. The old cow just sighs, no. All God's creatures got a place in the choir. Some sing low and some sing higher. Some sing out loud on the telephone wire. Some just clap their hands or paws or anything they got now. Listen to the top where the little birdie sings on the melody. I know it's singing. The hoot owl cries over everything. The blackbird disagrees. All God's creatures got a place in the choir. Some sing low and some sing higher. Some sing out loud on the telephone wire. Some just clap their hands or paws or anything they got now. Singing in the nighttime, singing in the day when the little duck quacks and he's on his way and the otter hasn't got much to say. A porcupine talks to himself. All God's creatures got a place in the choir. Some sing low and some sing higher. Some sing out loud on the telephone wire. Some just clap their hands or paws or anything they got now.
Let's do that one more time. And I know it's hot in here, but let's do it one more time like we really mean it, okay? Let's do it.
All God's creatures got a place in the choir. Some sing low and some sing higher. Some sing out loud on the telephone wire. Some just clap their hands or paws or anything they got now.
Excellent work. Good morning. Welcome to First Unitarian. Welcome to our animal blessing. You've probably gathered, it's a little bit of an unusual Sunday here. Often for those of us who are in person, we gather outside, but it's raining and we have a church with a concrete floor. So we thought, let's come inside. Messes might be okay. Noises might be okay. Sounds, whether they come from non-human animals or human animals, are definitely okay. We are so glad that you are here. We are so glad that you are the church with us. And of course, the church isn't this building. It's not even the webs of connection, the fibers that connect those of us who are joining online, but it's a people with a purpose, with a shared mission. And here at First Unitarian, our mission is through spiritual connection in community. We listen deeply to others and ourselves. We open to wonder and transformation, and we serve together with love and humility. I'm the Reverend Sherry Halliday Kwan. I'm one of the ministers that serves this congregation, and I use them and they and she and her pronouns, and I am joined by a whole lot of people helping lead worship, not least of which are our four-legged and otherwise animal companions who will be blessed today as part of our service, but who bless us every day as part of our lives. We begin our services here at First Unitarian, joining in a practice shared by Unitarian Universalists around the world by lighting our chalice. And our children and our adults use different words on most Sundays, but on the Sundays that we come together, we make sure to use at minimum the set that our children know. And so leading our chalice lighting today is our Director of Religious Education, Sheila Hsu.
Everyone ready? Life is a gift for which we are grateful. We gather in community to celebrate the glories and the mysteries of this great gift. And if you want to join me with ASL.
Thank you, Sheila. Thank you all who know and participate in that. I know that not all of us do, and so I'm going to teach you something else that involves using our bodies. It's not ASL, but a prayer to introduce you to our seasonal theme. We start our church year roughly around the same time as a school year, and we begin each year with a sense of, well, we don't know what's to come. We know that we're setting out on this year together with the companions to the left and the right and the front and behind us, but none of us know everything that we will need to know all by ourselves. We are on a fool's journey, and the fool from tarot and imperial courts in a number of places throughout history holds a very special place in truth-telling. The fool makes you laugh, and then the fool makes you think. The fool moves out into the world knowing relatively nothing. And on the Rider-Waite deck, which is in many ways the best-selling and most well-known tarot deck, the fool is depicted cloaked in heavenly cloth, in light blue,
a divine prince from another world journeying in this world, knowing relatively little. He moves out into the world confident, ready to face whatever comes. And so I ask you all to, whether you'd like to stand or seated, however you are comfortable, hold out your body as if you are ready to receive whatever comes. We move out into the world ready to receive. Below us, just like the fool, there's a white flower. This white flower is something he carries with him his whole life. It's a reminder of death, a reminder that we don't have all the time in the world. But it's a pretty beautiful flower, a simple reminder. And up above him, he carries a sack that strangely is both high up into the air, but huge, and yet not heavy. This sack is full of the collective wisdom, all that he will know and will need to know, but that he doesn't already know. It's the wisdom of those around him. And below him, behind him, is a little dog. A dog nipping at his heels, but not unfriendly, not threatening, not violating, not mean, not cruel, loving, supportive, a little louder than is always convenient, a little more joyful than he always feels, but a loyal companion, someone rooting him on. So let's do that again, these motions. We start ready to receive the world. Down below us, a reminder that we don't have all the time. Ahead and above, wisdom that others carry for us. And behind us, a loyal encourager. We'll do that one more time without words. You may be seated. Welcome on this fool's journey. May we laugh today and in the weeks to come. May we be invited to think today and in the weeks to come. May here in community we find wisdom that we do not yet have but is carried by others. May we find loving companions ready to embrace the world. We know we do not have all the time, but this time is ours. May we use it well.
So practically speaking, what does it look like, or what does it feel like, to open yourself like this to things that you don't know? It was a question I had to deal with earlier this summer, this question of being the holy fool. And one of the things I think about being a holy fool is it really lifts up this second part of our mission, which is to open to wonder and transformation, right, as Sherry said. So this summer, early in the summer, my partner Ed came inside. It was about 7 or 8 in the morning, and he comes and he said, "Sheila, there is a fawn in the bamboo." And I was like, "What?" Outside my bedroom window, down below, there's a whole patch of bamboo that Ed had cut down, and so it was all like a big leaves and everything. And so sure enough, in that bedding, there was a little fawn, and you could see its spots, and you could see its little head. And I'm sitting there going, "Oh my gosh." All right, the first human thoughts I have are, something's wrong with it. You know, it's lost its family. It's been abandoned. It's sick. You know, why is it here in the backyard of my house? So my partner and I are watching it, I guess in this stance, right? In this openness of, I wonder what's going on with this baby. Hour goes by, 2 hours go by, we're checking on her, on the little baby, and we see nothing. We see all kinds of deer on our property, but there's none around. So it's about noontime, and I'm starting to get anxious because you can see the fawn starting to pant because it's getting hotter and hotter, and the afternoon goes on. And I'm like, oh my gosh, so what are we going to do about this? Ed is leaving on a trip at 3 o'clock. He's going on a plane. And so I start to have human thoughts of, I'm going to have to intervene here. Should I go to Savers and get a baby bottle? You know, I'm thinking to myself, how am I going to take care of this little fawn in my yard? Ed leaves, and I'm still wondering how I'm going to deal with this baby. So about 4 or 5 o'clock, I go onto the back porch, and sure enough, a doe comes by. So this is 7 o'clock in the morning till about 4 or 5 in the afternoon. We've been watching this fawn, wondering, like, what's going on here? The deer comes by, the doe, about 10 or 15 yards from the fawn, and sure enough, that baby gets right up, trots over to mom and starts nursing right under her, right there by the creek. And the two of them trot on together up across the creek, which I caught on film, which I'll post on Facebook, if you're on Facebook, on our page. So what I learned in that moment, what I later learned and understood about deer, is that the does will drop off their fawns in a safe location, go out, eat all this food to get their milk up, and come back and pick up their babies, and then go on their way. Nature has it that it has built this into their way of traveling so that the moms don't wear out the babies traipsing around with them. Makes sense, right? Yeah. So afterwards, I felt like kind of like a fool, right? I'm dealing with the foolishness that our culture probably has put in me over the years that, like, you know, humans have this domination viewpoint, right? That our, even the wild animals around us, we either think of it as utilitarian, our culture, like, you know, even earlier in the summer, I was thinking, how dare that deer eat my echinacea, right? How many of you were thinking negatively of a wild animal this summer? I was. I had mice in my drawer, all kinds of things. But the way that this wonder can transform our view is that being the holy fool and being in that position of wonder about what I don't know can actually help us with our foolishness, that especially the culture will teach us about things that actually isn't as full of a full picture of the wholeness of those creatures in this case, right? So for me, it not only transformed my view or my understanding of what deer are. They're not a menace to me. They're not there to eat my plants. They're not there to hit my car, right? But they have this whole other relational life going on that I don't probably understand this much of, right? So if I open myself to that, it also transformed me in terms of our land. Like, I'm not the only mother on our land, right? I'm not the only partner on our land. There are many, many relationships going on around us that if we just open to wonder, can actually transform our sense of being in relationship where we are. So being a holy fool, that's the way I think it actually translates in terms of our mission.
We are all connected, and here in community, one of the spiritual practices that we undertake when we gather together is to take up a collection each Sunday. And the money that we collect online and in person, in baskets, well, it goes to support the work and witness of this community, but each week we split it in half with the community organization, a partner in the greater Rochester area or beyond, doing something that helps live out our mission into the greater world. And so this week we split our Sunday collection with the Spiritus Christi Prison Outreach. This program, in a number of ways, provides wraparound services for families and those who are leaving prison and incarceration to help build a life afterwards. Our collective generosity helps support the mission of this church, both within these walls and beyond. Our offering will now be humbly given and received. When I was in high school, the meanest, tallest, and biggest teacher made a point about saying he didn't watch movies whenever students tried to talk with him about something they had seen or wanted to see. It wasn't that he didn't want to connect with students, but he always said, "When I was a kid, I saw Old Yeller, and the dog died at the end, and that crushed me, and I never went back." And I think he was joking, but decades later, I went back to ask him, and he said, "No, that was the truth. The loss of pets cuts deeply. The grief and the mourning of the loss of a companion, someone who journeys with us for a short or a long time, but that we let into our homes and our hearts, cuts deeply." And we gather each year to bless and to celebrate the companions who live among us, those who help weave us into a web of connection. But we remember too, at this time of year, those who have died, who have passed, who journeyed with us for a while, and yet whose loss is felt and known. And so I take up the invitation offered by our young adults last week, when they asked us to witness to each other, when we asked ourselves to be present to those around us when we gather. And so I ask you to find a neighbor, and if you're online, to type into the chat and to share if you're carrying grief around a pet or an animal that was once a part of your life but is no longer with us. To share just briefly the name of that pet and something that you loved about them. And if you are someone who is not carrying this grief, let this be an opportunity simply to witness to one another, to be present to the person that you are with. And so here in the sanctuary, find a partner. And if you're online, type into the chat and let us hold together the truth and the beauty of our lives. There is so much to love and share. And so if you haven't switched, just make sure you do so now. All right, I invite you back in, not into silence. There will be whimpers and meows and barks aplenty. But I invite you to ground yourself into your seat. And if they reach the ground, placing your feet upon the ground. Please join me in the spirit of prayer and meditation. Spirit of life and love, source of endings and beginnings, God of many names, no name at all, and one abundant love. We are held in between barks. May these whimpers, the sounds of our animal companions, be our cry also. May we feel connected to the pulse of life. May the animals among us, those lost and loved, those here with us breathing, and those who are stuffed animals carrying love into this sanctuary and into our hearts, may they surround us. May all who care for our animal companions, domesticated and wild, be loved. May farmers, may ranchers, may zookeepers, may pet keepers, may conservationists, and may the wide-eyed wild wanderers among us know that this web of creation is both ours to tend to and steward, and to be held and cared for. None of us are the only parents. None of us are the only fawns. We are connected and we are held in the palm of love. In this spirit of blessing one another, I invite you to take what you have heard, what you have seen in the chat, or listened to from your partner. And in our chat, if you're joining us online, I invite you to name something that animals bring into the life that you lead or those that you love. It might be joy, it might be patience, it might be tenacity. It might be small gifts that you didn't know that you wanted. And here in person, I invite you to approach one of the altars in the center aisle and light a candle in memory of the animals who have come and gone from this life, those temporary royals from another world. May they be remembered and loved here. Please come light candles or raise a hand if you would like a candle to be brought to you. May the memory of all held here be a blessing. Amen.
I'm Reverend AJ. I use he and him pronouns. And I want to offer a brief selection, minorly adapted, from a novel to prepare us as we move in to the animal blessing. We've talked about our interconnectedness and the blessings of animal and the memories. But there's a piece in Gilead by Marilyn Robinson that talks about blessing and what that means and what's going on there. So the novel takes the form of a letter or a journal that a dying elderly Congregationalist minister writes so that his 7-year-old son may know something of his life. And so, reflecting on a moment from his own childhood, this minister recalls, "We were very pious children from pious households in a fairly pious town, and this affected our behavior considerably. Once, we baptized a litter of cats. It occurred to one of the girls to swaddle them up in a doll's dress. There was only one dress, which was just as well, since the cats could hardly tolerate a moment in it. It would have been unswaddled as soon as they were christened, in any case. I myself moistened their brows, repeating the full Trinitarian doctrine formula. Their grim old crooked-tailed mother found us baptizing away by the creek and began carrying her babies off by the napes of their necks. We lost track of which was which, but we were fairly sure that some of the creatures had been born away before receiving the saving grace of Jesus, and that worried us a great deal. I still remember how those warm little brows felt under the palm of my hand. Everyone has petted a cat, but to touch it one like that, with the pure intention of blessing, is a very different thing. It stays the mind. For years, we would wonder what, from a cosmic viewpoint, we had done to them. It still seems to me to be a real question. There is a reality in blessing. It doesn't enhance sacredness, but it acknowledges it, and there is a power in that. I have felt it pass through me, so to speak. The sensation is one of really knowing a creature, I mean really feeling its mysterious life and your own mysterious life at the same time. I don't wish to be urging the ministry on you, but there are some advantages to it you might not know to take account of if I did not point them out. Not that you have to be a minister to confer blessing. You are simply much more likely to find yourself in that position. And so we gather this morning to bless the animals. Not because you need me or Reverend Sherry to confer the blessing, and not because we need a Sunday morning service to gather to do so, although sometimes church helps to remind us to do the things that we know we always want to do. And certainly not because blessing is a requisite for salvation. Our universalism proclaims that all souls are already saved, already worthy, already a blessing. But rather because there is a reality in blessing that acknowledges the sacredness that is already there, already here among us. And so as you come up to our pet or raise your hand for one of us, for Sheila or I to come and offer a blessing, or with the image of your pet or the memory of a beloved.
Hi, everyone. If you're joining us online, I would like to bless your pets. And so I invite you to type into the chat or to raise your hand if you have an animal that you would like to be blessed today. And I'm spotlit right now, but I invite you to go onto Zoom, onto Gallery, so that you might see other people's pets. I'm already seeing people start to pick up their cats and their dogs, and it is a joy. So if you'd like to type into the chat, I'd love to know the name of the pet that you would like blessed. Dolly, may Titan be blessed. May all who care for Titan be held in the web of creation. And if you have your video on, I will spotlight you also. But if you don't, that's okay too. I understand that might not always be possible. So, Mitch, may Jovi be blessed. May all who care for Jovi be held in the web of creation. Mary, may Lily be blessed. May you and all who care for Lily be held in the loving web of creation. Steve, I don't know if Pumpkin is there with you, and that's okay. We've just got you on screen, if that's okay, because this blessing is for you also. May Pumpkin be blessed. May you and all who care for Pumpkin be held in the loving web of creation. Joanne, I don't see you on camera, but I know that you are there. And Steve, I'll take you off of Spotlight so you don't feel like you have to hold all the blessings for all the people, but I know your love is in this web too. Marty, may you beautiful dog creature, may you be blessed. And may Joanne and all who care for you be held in the loving web of creation. Oh, I see Yuli's head there. Hi, Yuli, you big, beautiful dog. Yuli, may you be blessed. May you and Rachel and all who care for you and all who are cared by you be blessed. Massey, I know Pepper is somewhere, and I think you have returned to school, and so Pepper is here in Rochester with us while you have completed your summer internship with us, and so you're no longer in Rochester. But Pepper, may you be blessed.
Hey.
You and all who care for you be a blessing. Lucy, look at you. I don't know where your people are, but Lucy, may you be blessed, and may your people, one of whom I think is in the sanctuary here, and one who is there with you, may you be blessed, and may you be held in the loving web of creation. Fergus and Amma, two cats, who both bless us in their own way, and who can take all the blessings we can get, just like the rest of us. May you be blessed. And may Janice and all who care for you be held in the loving web of creation. Simba and Zoe, may you be blessed, and may your humans and all who care for you, may you be held in the loving web of creation. Kathleen, it's lovely to see you, and I don't know if Poppet is there with you. Oh, there's Poppet. Poppet, look at that face. May you be blessed, and not just because you are cute, but also because you are good, like all dogs. May you be blessed, and may all who care for you be held in the loving web of creation. Now, I don't know if that's Daisy or Isaiah.
Daisy.
Daisy,
flame,
you
but not the light of truth.
They move really fast in person. We're not going to worry about it. Daisy, may you and Isaiah be blessed. May you and all who care for you be held in the loving web of creation.
Thank you.
I am going to move to gallery view, and I invite you all to do the same. Jan, may Katie be blessed. May you and Craig and all who care for Katie be held in the loving web of creation. Norman, may you be blessed. May you and all who care for you be held in the loving web of creation. Yasmin, may you be blessed, and may John and Sue and all who care for you be held in the loving web of creation. Andy, I think that's Mirabelle, and Mirabelle is gloriously on camera. Mirabelle, may you be blessed, and may all who care for you be held in the loving web of creation. I am looking for our other animal friends on gallery view. Carol, there's Simba. May Simba be blessed, and may all who love Simba be held in the web of creation. Well, I don't know if this is Thea or Sadie, but Sadie and Thea and Aria and Electra, may you be blessed, and maybe you be held in the loving web of creation. I think I have all those who are on camera, but there are others still. May Kayo and Rhea and Mittens and Stevie be blessed. May Courtney and all who hold these cats in loving care be held in the loving palm of creation. And Cindy, I've seen your cats running around in your background, but I know they're hard to catch. So may Penny and Derby and Daisy be blessed. May you and all who care for them be held in the loving web of creation. And Chicky, may you be held in the loving web of creation. May all who care for you be blessed. Josie and Dragon and Gracie and Lucy, May you be blessed. May Richard and all who care for you hold and be held in this web of loving creation. Lily and Chevy, Eartha and Susie, whose names are incredible, may you be blessed. And may all who care for you be held in the loving web of creation. Mr. Elton, you hound dog, may you be blessed. May you be blessed, and may all who care for you be held in this web of creation, which is loving and good. May all these animals, Osiris and Anuba, Letha and Kip, and Sir Rudyard Kipling, may you be blessed. And may all these humans, those who care for them, be too not just a blessing in the lives of these animals, but held also in the web of creation. Sadie and Shiloh and Sasha, and I'll leave space too for the animal that is not yet here, but is yet to come. The animal that you might be dreaming of bringing into your home, or checking out on Pet Finder every day, just wondering if it's time. May that space and the presence of those already here be a blessing, and may these animals be blessed. May all who care for our creatures, big and small, be blessed and held in the love and grace of this world. We close our service this morning with Cornelius. Cornelius shares our blessing. And as a reminder, we don't bring our dogs to church, not in this congregation, every week. But we are so glad that they are here and connected with us. And so, Freddie, I see you asking in the chat, it'll have to wait till next year or the next time we're outside. But may our animals teach us patience and fortitude, joy and belonging. Not only the four-legged or slithering creatures here in our homes or in our sanctuary, our spiritual home, but all those who surround us in the world. May they call us to a journey where we do not need to hold all of the wisdom. As we end our time, I'm going to invite everyone here to unmute, and you're invited to make a joyful noise, a bark or a howl or a meow or a caw, whatever it is that your spirit calls you to, you are invited to do it. May you all be blessed. Go in peace. Stick around to chat in small groups. I leave you in the loving and capable hands of Craig, our chat host this morning.
Okay, I am going to set up breakout rooms, and if I can find it. And we'll automatically whisk you off into one of the five breakout rooms. And ask you to join them.
Craig, you might want to combine some of the singles.
Yeah, that's what I'm looking at. I got and Antis.
Have a great day, Craig.
Thanks, you too. See ya. Enjoy the rest of the weekend. Yeah, we've just got one room with Antice, Cindy and Joe Sokolowski, Elizabeth Milliken, Kathleen Plum, and Suzanne 2022, whoever that is. Not a lot of people stuck around.
Mary Lubinowski, has COVID, so does her daughter.
Oh, that's because what's going on?
Later.
Yeah, that's what Sherry said, that they had to sort of improvise.
Did you not use, you didn't use this dish?
No, I didn't see it.
Nice, it was right at the kitchen table.
Sorry.
Stop. And I did her sermon, I just listened to the next perfect part. I was talking about, grief,
yeah,
and that, like, when this grief over whatever, but this reference to, like, well, grief bursts when you have something, 10 years later reminds you of,
or is it, yeah,
some Mexico, so my mom died, and when I hear, even though I don't like Barry Manilow songs, when I hear a Barry Manilow song, and I hope that I instantaneously think of mom and like miss her. So there is raining in Detroit. They're supposed to be having their church picnic.
So, sorry, ma'am.
Do they do the blessing of the animals today too? He's going to not stop playing basketball.
We have perfect eggplants today.
I know. I'll find a recipe.
Thank you.